Let's go.
Sweetie.
It's just you and Andy and a few celebs.
Lady Gaga.
Kevin Bacon.
Sarah Jessica Parker.
Goldie Hawn.
Glenn Close.
Paris Hilton.
Matthew McConaughey.
Dionne Warwick.
I just got a big hug from John Mayer.
Big seated hug.
Hey, Huey Lewis.
John Hill said that he heard you have the biggest dick in music.
Well, it's all true, but I don't have it with me here in the studio.
He will be spilled.
It's Andy Cohen Live.
I don't think you guys are prepared for how manic of a Monday this is, because like Santa Claus, a gift was dropped in my lap on Friday night. That gift is my special co-host for our Monday edition of Andy Cohen Live. John Mayer is here, everybody, right across from me in person.
Hi, everyone. Hi, Andy.
Hi, John.
Thank you for letting me do this.
A two-hour kiki with John Mayer and our friends on the phone lines? This is exciting.
I'm very excited.
John Hill is out for the month. And John Mayer and I, it was a big headline in my life. I mean, I feel like Friday night I went to the Met Ball. But what I did was I had dinner with my old friend John Mayer. And not only that, we went out. To a restaurant.
We went out and then we went into a restaurant.
Exactly. Yeah. And let me say, and before we talk about that, John Mayer picked today's song, Manic Monday, that we just came in with. And I was surprised to see that you seemed to know every word of the song. You were mouthing every word.
Sure, it's a classic.
The Bangles.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I believe it was written by Prince. Yeah, Manic Monday.
Oh, yes, you're right. Yeah. Yes, you're right. Yes, you're right. Did you know Prince?
I didn't know him. I wouldn't say I knew him personally, but I had come into contact with him several times in my life. Never a dull moment.
Right.
I almost think he chose to make all his interactions with people memorable and,
right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
I don't think he liked to do anything but leave an impression where you weren't sure what that was all about.
Right.
So as to make sure that sitting here years later, it would be discussed.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Interesting. Not a bad way to live your life.
No.
Yeah.
No. And several times in my life, he would be on the guest list. Prince is coming tonight. And I go, oh, the Prince is coming tonight. And then he wouldn't come to the show. Which I wonder if that was a way of being like, hey, always put me on these couple people guest lists. Right. I'm not going.
Right.
But I just want to make sure that their reality gets a little strange.
There was a thing in New York City in the 90s among a certain generation of gay guys where every Saturday night there was a rumor that Madonna was going to show up at the Roxy, which was the huge, like a few thousand people club. And I mean, it would be 1 a.m. and I would be like, oh, I guess I have to go to the Roxy because Madonna's going to be there. And, you know, she showed up once every couple of years. She did. That was the thing. So it was always a possibility.
So just enough to make the rumor have some grit.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So that dinner Friday night, I got to tell you, it felt we were inside. It was your first time inside a restaurant eating in a year, right?
In a year. Yeah.
Wow.
This is my first time to New York in over a year.
Wow. And you are here. Why?
I came because I have not seen my dad since over a year ago, and he got vaccinated.
Oh, that's great.
And so as soon as he got that week after the second dose, I was on a plane out to see him.
Yeah. And he is 94?
He's 93.
Wow.
So, you know, I mean, there's no good year to lose to the pandemic. But
honestly,
when you're in your 90s, the years become more valuable. So the fact that I didn't see him for a whole year, and I got to say, I am the luckiest human being that my dad, who was in an assisted living home in New York City during the pandemic,
honestly,
literally survived. I mean, it's not dramatic to say he survived.
Right.
And so I know how many people can't say that. And so the value in that and the luck of that. And it is luck. It is luck.
It's so true.
It is not a meritocracy. People didn't survive because they were better than another.
Right.
It is just pure lottery luck that my dad literally survived. And it was a very heavy thing to see him again and know that at 93, we lost a year, but he's still here.
Oh, you were telling me the other night, you started playing guitar at 13.
Yeah.
And then I said, and when did you have your first hit record? You said 23. So how incredible that in 10 years.
I still think about it since dinner. I'm still thinking about it.
That's crazy. But another thing you said is your dad was saying something to you about music. And I don't think I realized how into music your dad was.
My dad was a piano player.
Okay.
He would play at the Rotary Club.
Uh-huh.
And he would play off the page, you know? And so he was a written music player, and I was an improv spacey. I mean, I would put the Sunday circulars on the music stand on the piano, and I would sing what I was reading on the Sunday circulars. Tied, 2 for $1.29.
Is that true? Did you?
Oh, yeah, because I didn't know how to read music. So I would read Sunday circulars and sing them just to have something to sing, you know?
Wow.
And so he didn't quite understand the music thing as I was practicing it, because he went, well, if I put up a sheet of music in front of you, you couldn't read it. What is this all about? And I still don't know if he quite gets how I've made it.
That's amazing.
I can't read music.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Can you hear our Kiki music? Can you hear what
I heard
song
a little
is?
Bit, but I feel like we're in between songs right now.
No. It's a slow.
Oh, yeah, there it is.
Do you know what that is?
That's this. It's My House.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's It's My
House. Is this the original recording, or is this a needle drop sort of?
I think this is an extended mix.
Got it.
Yeah.
It's the 10-inch.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
These are all my old albums from growing up, by the way. You might be interested to know. So, anyway, I loved having dinner with you the other night. I left you a message on Saturday morning. I was like, I felt so overstimulated by it. I felt like we just had a lot of conversation. Yes. It was so nice. And it really, one thing this year has made us all do, I think, is take stock and appreciate things that we have, our homes, the ability to go out to dinner with friends.
Yep.
It's really something else.
But you know what I think because I'm experiencing a little bit of a return to normality. It's like one step out of 100 steps to normality, just to have dinner on Friday night. I really think that we're going to have to sort of rebuild our stamina for going out. I find now
100%.
When I go out, an hour will do me.
Yes.
Because we've sort of bonded with being alone.
Yes.
And there's a little Stockholm syndrome. Where you go, well, I want to go back to my cage now.
I totally agree.
Do you know what I mean?
No, I totally do. And the thing is, Ben has really made that. I am so much more inclined to just be home with Ben. And I want to put him to bed every night.
Yeah.
And I do put him to bed every night. And it's like, so then he goes to bed at 8. So then, am I going to go out to dinner at 8? I mean, that is typically when I would normally go out, 8 or 8:30. I don't know. But
we're going to have to rebuild the conditioning to go to dinner and go out after that. Because we're so used to feeding ourselves socially or entertainment-wise.
Yeah.
So we're on our own little schedules now. And it's like, well, I got to be in the living room in 10 minutes to do this thing I do. So when you go out, I feel like we're really going to have to go half an hour at a time over a series of months.
Yes. Something funny happened to me last night, actually, when I was putting Ben to bed. And that is, I always have music on in my apartment. And usually I'm listening to The Dead, usually. And I have to say, I listen to a fair amount of Dead and Company. You will be
happy
to know.
Yes, you do. No,
And I had Dead and Company on last night. I went to Spotify and put in Dead and Company, and there's a lot of just great Dead and Co. playlists. Morning Dew started, and it was around the time I was brushing his teeth, so it was probably like 7:47. And I was like,
wait, you brush his teeth at what, 7:45 every night?
Something like that, because he's done with his milk and then brush his teeth. So I was brushing his teeth and Morning Dew started, and I was like, ooh. And I was like, you know what? I'm going to turn. Usually I like to turn the music off so there's no stimulation.
Sure.
And we just have quiet time and I really dim the lights and we do our own thing. But I was like, I cannot turn Morning Dew off. Like, I have to hear this song. So I go, you know what? I'll just listen to Morning Dew, you know, and then, well, you know, the punchline is that it was like a 22-minute version of Morning Dew. It was such a joke. To the point, and it was so good, by the way, and I knew you were coming. I was like, let me see when this Morning Dew is from.
And when
so I will tell you when it was from, and you tell me if you even have any memory. It was from the Lochan Festival in 2018. Any idea?
I know what happened at that festival.
Right. Any memories from that gig?
Well, Branford came out at that festival.
Branford Marsalis came out.
Really? And he played on Eyes of the World and a couple other songs. And it was, God bless the guy. Coming out to play with those. You know, I remember being there. And even though I'm the guy who sings and plays the guitar, that I was very much the visitor to that. I mean, he was the guest on that stage that night, but he has more history on that stage than I do. And I remember being like, oh, you're actually higher up on the call list.
Uh-huh.
And it was like, how did that feel to you? I just worry to this day that he wanted to do that with me around. Because his memories are of playing with Jerry.
Right.
And so there are these times when someone shows up from the Grateful Dead past where I just become like pure deference. Because even though I might be the guy in that moment, there's a thing they see and remember that I don't have those memories. So it was very interesting and very generous of him to come play with me, knowing that I'm not a part of that lineage in his mind.
Have you played with Bruce Hornsby, who was a Dead?
I've known Bruce for a while.
You have.
And so I've played with him on stuff like, you know, like charity shows or benefit shows or tribute shows and stuff. And he came in the studio one night and we messed around. He's fantastic, man.
You and I were talking about this the other night at dinner. I was saying to you that I had heard myself on Howard and that I had said that I had been at dinner with Emilia Clarke from Game of Thrones at the Met Ball, and I had totally forgotten about it because I hadn't watched Game of Thrones. And of course, now I'm like killing myself because I would do anything to have dinner with Emilia Clarke at this moment.
And I told you how great it is.
And you said, well, that's funny. There have been people in your life that you've realized later that you played with or met. And you were like, wow, I was in the presence of greatness, but I didn't realize it at that time. So who have some of those people been? If you can say.
Yeah, I mean, I played with Phil and Friends, or I opened for Phil and Friends in 2004.
Lesh.
Yes, thank you.
Okay.
Phil Lesh from Grateful Dead. And I opened for him in 2005. Uh-huh. And he was a great guy. And I knew he was from the Grateful Dead. I just didn't quite know the lay of the land.
Yeah.
And I did a charity. I think I did a Michael J. Fox benefit. And Levon Helm was from the band.
Yeah.
Was the drummer. And I know ambiently at the time, I know the band, but I didn't get into the band's music until after that gig. And so to your point exactly, you go, oh my God, I was standing right next to the guy,
right?
And I didn't quite appreciate what that all was.
Yeah.
And so it still happens to this day, you know, you'll hang out with someone and go, oh, that's neato, and then a year later you'll fall in love with their music and go, I already met them. And you wish you could have changed the sequence of events.
Well, funnily enough, I'm now thinking about when I went with you to Mexico for the first Playin' in the Sand, which was a Dead show in Mexico. And we had dinner with and smoked it up with George R. R. Martin. And now I had not watched Game of Thrones.
How would you have been different now if he were there? Would you have talked Game of Thrones with him?
1,000%. I find, and tell me if you... I find that more often than not, people are happy to talk about the thing that they're known for. People come up, especially if it's someone who, like if someone's really smart or an author or a celebrity or something comes up to me and says, I know the last thing you want to do is talk Housewives, but can I just say, I'm usually pretty happy about it, or someone who's just a super fan, because I'm like, they love the show and I love the show. And so I would like to that George R.R. Martin, maybe if I had an interesting take, that he would be like, yeah, I'm happy to talk about
and
this.
And you're you, which you can't hide.
Yeah, but he had no idea who I am. But
everyone knows who you are.
Well, did Khaleesi, I mean, I don't know. I guess, listen, there's a fine line between annoying and, but I think he would have been okay with that.
Let me ask you a question.
Yes.
And let's take this away from being about George R.R. Martin.
Yes.
I don't want to personalize it with his name on it.
Okay.
But let's say you love a show like Game of Thrones. But maybe I do want to be hypothetical about George R.R. Martin. Maybe I do.
Okay.
And you see him at a party and you want to talk Game of Thrones with him because you love the show. And he, what would the word be? Rebuffs you?
Yes.
Would you still love the show as much?
Yes, 1,000%. Don't you find, it's so funny, I've had this conversation with my mom actually a few times, because there's that thing with celebrities where Kelly Ripa taught me this actually, where I've said to her before, I cannot believe how nice you are to everyone who comes up to you. And she's not just nice, she is incredibly engaging, she's wonderful, whatever. And she has said, if it's a bad experience, they will never forget it. If it's a good experience, it's a good experience. If it's bad, they'll talk about it until the day they die.
Right.
And you know, I don't know how it's come up with my mom, where she's said, and I've said to her, you know, Mom, sometimes you have to give someone a break. Like, maybe they didn't feel like, maybe they just got bad news.
Right.
Maybe there was a moment in their life where it wasn't okay for them. But she met this Cardinals player who's now an announcer named Mike Shannon at the airport in the 60s, I think. And she literally is like, yeah, but Mike Shannon's a dick. And I'm like, Mom, you don't understand. Now apply this to, maybe he was at the airport having a bad day. Maybe he was hungover. Who knows? Yeah, you know?
Had to poop so badly.
Had to poop so badly. But it's so funny. But it is I would say George R.R. Martin didn't feel like talking about it at that moment.
Good for you.
I personalized it again.
Good. Well, you have to. You have to give it some context.
Yes. Natalie from California has a good broad question for you. Yeah, Natalie.
Hey, good morning. What a cool trip to ask John Mayer a question at 7 o'clock in the morning.
I know. Are you driving to work, Natalie?
I am.
What do you do?
My coffee and I work at a large animal diagnostic lab in California. So I work
very good.
Wow. LADL. You work over at the LADL. Do you ever call it the LADL? Operation Ladle.
Operation Ladle. Failed CBS pilot.
It's amazing.
Yeah, they ordered a script, but they didn't.
Mark Harmon.
LADL.
Mark Harmon. NCS.
LADL. Oh, my God. Juliana Margulies, we thought we were going to hit it.
This German Shepherd was shot through and through. But give me a second. Here's what's strange.
Yeah.
There were two
bullets. German Shepherd. Natalie, what's your question for John Mayer?
Okay, cool. Just a random thought. What is left on John Mayer's life bucket list?
Great question. There's one thing left, and that's wife and kids.
Oh, good answer.
Easy. Wife and kids. Wife and kids. That would complete all of it. And I thought about this as recently as last night, because my brothers are both married and have children. Yep.
And I asked you Friday night, at what age you think you will have children?
My dad was 50 when he had me.
Yep. I was 50 when I had Ben.
I think the age is not determined by anything other than when you think you're done needing things from the world for just you.
That is exactly what my approach was. That was my feeling. So you feel like 50 is a good age for you to...
I think if I work backwards, it's 50.
Yes.
48, 50.
Yes.
But I have... So I don't feel late to the party.
Yep.
Because I know only now is my tummy sore from all the frosting I've eaten off the cake of life.
I I love the way you speak.
You just have to be done playing with your toy.
Yes.
Of me and my life and my I've come to a point in my life where with this stuff, I'm not fatigued completely, but my hands are on my knees a little bit. And I'm going, okay, I have definitely explored the life of what can be done for me, by me.
Uh-huh.
So I don't feel late, because I would never want to have a wife and kids while I was still investigating what's out there for me to be explored by me.
So let me ask you this. If Natalie from California had called this show 15 years ago, and it was John Mayer, 25-year-old, and she said, like, what's your bucket list? As a performer, what do you think you would have said?
It would have been something like, do a song with Eddie Vedder from Pearl Jam. It would have been very much like musically oriented.
Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, I was the first to the bag on for so many things in my family. It should make sense that there are a couple things I'm late to the bag with.
Right.
Everything in my life was like, boom, I'm playing guitar at 14, exactly as I want to.
Right.
I found the thing I love.
First one in your family to win a Grammy?
First one in my family to win a Grammy.
Well, that begs the question.
How happy
have
are
there
you?
Been other
there
Grammys?
No, there are no other mayors who've won Grammys. How happy are you, and I think this is true, that you're the only famous person in your family? Would you be okay if someone else in your family was famous?
Yeah, I think it would be fine.
I would have a terrible problem with it.
You would. Yeah. You would.
It's my affliction.
Well, let me say that it's your affliction, but let me also say this. It would beget so many problems. I mean, like, there's no, it would be very difficult for it to go smoothly.
Yeah, you're the black
sheep.
Because
it would be like, what, my sister M.
Your sister M.
What did you say about me on the radio yesterday?
That yes.
Now, you know, right. You know, like, or.
I'm the weird one in the family, you
right,
say. I'm
right.
The one in the family who understands things you don't get.
Right.
And you
right.
ask questions like, you know, I mean, I want to be the person people go, how do you do that?
Right.
Can't
right.
be someone else going like, yeah, like my older brother going like, well, I've got that NBC meeting tomorrow.
Right.
That's mine.
Oh, that is really funny.
Yeah. So that's my bucket. That's a really good question.
And good
that's
question, Natalie. I like that.
Easy answer.
Have you ever jumped out of a plane?
No. I'm not into doing things against mitigating death and injury. I'm trying to
narrow. Have you ever bungee jumped?
No, right. Not interested. I travel, and you know that you have the same life. My bungee jumping is getting on airplanes all the time. That's
right.
I already tempt fate. I mean, I can't believe that I'm 43 years old.
Right.
And the hundreds of planes that have landed.
Yes, it's true.
Perfectly.
Yes.
So
that's true.
I don't need to go tempting. Yeah. Unless you love it, right? Like,
right.
I mean, I've heard of people who loved skiing or like extreme skiing so much that like at their funeral, that people aren't really crying.
Right.
They're like, this guy loved skiing. Right. I would only want to
skier.
No, never skied.
Really?
On account of their wrists.
Wow. Interesting.
I was a guitar player so young in life.
Wow.
30 years is what we were talking about at dinner. I didn't notice that it was 30 years in last month that
right.
I was. So
wow.
I was 13 when I played guitar, way before I ever would want to ski.
John Mayer celebrating 40 years of excellence. That's what all the logos and invitations
on
your 40th.
For my 40th birthday.
Your tambourine is right
John
there
Mayer,
that you sent.
40 years of excellence.
See your tambourine?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was the invitation.
Yes. Allison in Philadelphia. I love what she has to say. I wonder how many people can say this. Say what you have to say, Allison.
Say what you have to say.
Allison, you there?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Hi.
Hello. Hi, can you hear me? Sorry.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hi. I really became a huge John Mayer fan because of you. Obviously, heard of you, John, and I certainly knew your music, but I really became like a deep diver into your old stuff. But I became a true fan. Yeah.
Isn't that great?
I love that. I love that. See that, John? And that's why if you ever come out with more music, I would like a cut because I think there are extra fans. Thanks, Allison. We got to take a break. This portion of Andy Cohen Live is brought to you by California Almonds, natural fuel for the naturally best you. Own your everyday, every day. We'll be right back with more John Mayer. Phone lines are open, 844-305-ANDY, 844-305-2639. You've got both of us for 90 more minutes. We'll be right back. The 75-inch TV, not the 50. The ribeye, not the sirloin. Business, not coach. There are times when paying a little more is worth it, just like there's a world of difference between the stretched out sadness in your drawers and Tommy John underwear. When you're wearing Tommy John underwear, you're that much more comfortable, so you can do everything better. That's why Tommy John doesn't have customers, they have fanatics. Because with dozens of comfort innovations,
once you've tried Tommy John underwear, you're never going back. Innovations like breathable, lightweight, moisture-wicking fabric with four times the stretch of competing brands.
With over 13 million pairs sold, men across America love Tommy John underwear because they keep everything in place. No more flopping or sticking to yourself. And Tommy John underwear comes with a non-rolling waistband for the perfect fit. The legs never ride up and you're covered with their no wedgie guarantee.
Returns and exchanges are free, and right now get 15% off your first order at TommyJohn.com/Andy.
That's 15% off Tommy John underwear and loungewear at TommyJohn.com/Andy.
And Andy, take a look at this. What does that say?
Are you wearing Tommy John right now?
I'm wearing Tommy John right now. That's TommyJohn.com/Andy. See the site for details.
He really is wearing it, folks. Pay. Not a bad song, John Mayer.
You know, I have the great honor and joy of listening to these songs and remembering where I was. And
where were you when you wrote that song?
I was in Los Angeles. I was living in an apartment in Santa Monica. I remember waking up one morning and having that idea. I remember riding my bike down Venice Beach and working on this song. I remember every little guitar thing I worked out. And it was
Isn't
great.
It funny? This song is so 2020.
I mean,
we even talked about you performing this song on New Year's Eve this year.
Yeah,
with me and Anderson.
It's a boomerang of a song. It kind of comes around and around. Now, no one's ever fully agreed with the sentiment, which I like. I like imperfect narrative. You know, I think there's always going to be somebody going like, well, I don't think you should wait. And that's the fun part of that song is, you know, but there's a reality that there have been times, and I think there will be more times where you go, well, we just got to wait this clock out, you know? So, I get to hear these songs and like the song, but also go like, now I'm old enough to go like, oh, I remember that guy.
If you're in the car and you're listening to The Bridge, say, and one of your songs comes on, do you listen to the song or do you change the channel?
I'll check it out. If it's just me, I'll check it out.
If you're home and you're flipping through the channels and an X comes on the television.
There's the Andy I know
and
love.
Do you watch the program or the music video or whatever that they're on?
Good question.
Okay.
I don't believe that there's anyone on the boogeyman list anymore.
Right.
Because, you know, when you have a recent X, we had boogeyman vibes.
Right. For everyone.
For everyone.
Yes.
I don't believe I have any boogie people in my life at the moment. I don't know that I'd watch a whole program.
Okay.
If somebody were performing, I would definitely watch the performance. And I enjoy watching it. Sometimes I'm a fan. Like, I can watch and go like, nailed it.
Right. If an ex of yours comes out with a song, do you ever wonder, is that about me?
Yes. Sometimes I hope it's about me. Sometimes it's a really good song. And I go, and I listen. Sometimes, yeah, I mean, I don't think it's a dirty admission. Sometimes a song is so good, I go, man, I hope that's about me.
Right.
Let me explain. At a certain age, these relationships, they sort of go into this legacy category,
right,
where they're no longer jangling your nerves or making you upset, and you're just lucky to have a job. You're glad to be a musician. You're glad to be a fan of music, and so music comes out, and I check everyone's music out. I'm a fan. Like, at some point in your life, these things have to sort of revert. At some point, you know, to that's what happens in life, and those are the exchanges that you have as you grow up.
Yeah.
And at some point you get in the car and go, oh, new record's out, I'm checking it out.
Yeah.
And sometimes those songs are really good, and I have no problem admitting to you, I don't think anyone's, oh, we're on the radio? Oh. that I go, man, this song's really good. I would be quite jazzed if this were about me. But, it's probably not. I mean, I'm one of the world's worst masochists by way of being optimistic, you know?
Right.
But at some point, if everything was fair and things did or didn't work out, I mean, at some point, what, 10 years? It's got to revert to everyone's... Thank God everyone's healthy and here and still doing what they do. But I definitely sometimes I break out my magnifying glass and I go, any codes?
Right.
Any secret codes?
Right.
And it's like, no, not for you.
When you were last on the show, you shared a story about getting underwear for Shawn Mendes.
Yes.
And now I'm thinking about, you just had your Tommy John underwear on during that promo. Is that what you sent him?
No. The story was that he needed underwear, and I had my assistant go get him a big bag of underwear. But he never took the underwear from the studio.
Oh, he didn't?
He didn't take. So I had all his underwear. Now, when I say his underwear, it was sort of clickbait. I was being clickbaity.
Yes, okay.
It was meant for him.
Exactly.
And I don't remember what I did with it because they
Can
were not
I have
my
it?
Size. I would wish I could give them to you.
I'm just kidding.
and they were Under Armour.
So you... So he is often at the recording studio that you work at when you're recording?
Not often, but there are times he comes in, and there's only a finite number of studios in LA.
Right.
Because studios are kind of dwindling in terms of their need for most artists.
Right.
So we run into, right. I mean, every time I see him, it's just a gift when the universe pairs us up for a day.
Really?
It's
Why?
I just will do anything for that kid.
You love him.
I love him. He's so pure. He's so pure. He's an artist without the trauma.
Wow.
And most artists are born from some kind of catalytic thing that trauma is a part of. And I look at him and I'm like, you're me without getting shaken up like a soda can, for.
How do you two communicate?
We text a lot.
You text a lot.
He has such great taste and opinions on things. That it really is both of us looking up to each other. It's not this sort of, Obi-Wan Luke thing. I mean, I'll send him stuff of mine and he'll give me really good perspective on it.
Right.
I mean, I just talked to him about my album cover,
Right.
And I go, I don't know whether I should put myself on the album cover, sometimes I don't want to put my picture on the album cover. And he goes, the world wants a record with you on the album cover. And I went, you're right. And he convinced me to put the next record I do, I'm going to be on the album cover.
That's funny because I think you and I had the opposite conversation.
Well, I had a conversation with you about what I'd do if I didn't.
Right, okay.
But I know that what happens is you always, before the photo shoot, you're like, I think this album cover is just going to be some text and be
right.
Weird. And then you get the photos back and you're excited.
Like, oh, these are great.
You go, these are great.
I know, but I know we're talking hypothetically, but I thought that the idea that was bandied around on Friday was pretty good too. Chris from New York has a question on that topic. Yes, Chris.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi, good morning. Good morning, Andy. Good morning, John. This made my
good morning.
Week. And hello to Ben.
Thank you.
Love him too. I had a question for you, John. Like many of us as huge fans of yours and huge fans of music, we're all looking at 2021 like, what does it mean musically? My question to you is, what does it look like to you musically? Because we're all wondering.
Good question. Nobody knows any more than another person on this. I have sporadic conversations with agents and managers about when we might be able to go back out. And it seems to me like people are just discussing 2022.
Right. And what about, and that's for Dead & Co too.
Dead & Co, there's a little more optimism. I mean, there's no reason to sort of be veiled about. I mean,
if you can, you'll be
definitely
back.
Will. I don't think anybody wants to put up another tour and take it down.
Right.
And
exactly.
So there's this balance of wanting to be encouraged and encouraging, you know, to put it out in the universe that we could go out. But I think what this pandemic has done is shown us how short a month is.
Right.
You know, I mean, we could talk about June right now, right? And you go, June, I could count down three more months and we're almost at June. And right. You know how fast these months are going. So if you look at what's happening in the world versus what's happening in terms of how quickly you rip off the calendar page on the wall, it starts looking like 22 is the only way that you can start really booking stuff and being sure that you wouldn't have to write that Instagram post that goes, guys, we really talked this over and we can't do it. I just don't think anyone wants to put dates up they'd have to take down.
All right. Thank you, Chris.
I hear that. Well, we miss you so much.
I miss you too. Thank you. I love you right back. I can't imagine that we won't be on stage whenever we're up there and have tears in our eyes.
You know what I have sitting on my desk that I've had on my desk since you gave it to me?
Tell me.
Because I did not know what to do with it because it was so good.
I'm looking.
And that is that John sent me for Christmas in 2017.
Yeah.
And he made me the cutest little cowboy card.
No, that's a vintage stationery from the 50s or 60s.
It's incredible. And he gave me the harmonica that he used to record Whiskey with, which is one of my favorite John Mayer songs.
It's the only harmonica that I thought to be like, oh, let me put this in a Ziploc bag or something.
Right.
So yeah, I recorded Whiskey. And that for sure did. Other ones I just,
right.
I'm a collector, so I never want to.
And this is on my desk, just so you know.
Yeah, it's the, just I mean, so and also, what do you do with a harmonica?
What do you do?
It's a paperweight.
It's a paperweight.
It literally is a paperweight for the card.
I know it is. Yeah. I just don't know what to. I just don't know what to. Ben got a potty since we last spoke. He is so proud of his potty. He brought, the other day we were in my bathroom and he left the room and he came back in and he brought his potty in.
You're telling me he has his own?
He has his own little portable potty. He doesn't know how to do anything in it yet.
But if he did, that would be okay because it's made for that?
Yes, it's made for him to pee-pee and poo-poo in, and he will now be learning how to do that. But it is the cutest thing. And this morning we were in his room, and he went and he got the potty, and he sat in front of – there's the level of pride that he takes at showing me that he can sit on the potty, and it is very cute.
So he's learning the negotiation of – I think I have to go.
Yes.
And what that means. So would that be your sign that he has to go potty if he's...
Well, no. I don't think that he's taking... I think he's quite happy pooping himself and letting me change his diapers. And the truth of the matter is I'm kind of okay with it still, too.
Will you be sad the last day you get to do that?
That's a good question. I don't know. It depends how much of a pain in the ass him going to the potty is going to wind up being.
Right.
All right, we're going to take a break and come back with more. 844-305-ANDY, 844-305-2639. We'll be right back.
It's just a phase, but I still might have a ways to go.
See what's again.
We are back. Andy Cohen Live, Monday edition. Special guest host today, John Mayer. And when John Mayer comes back in the room, I'm going to remember what his middle name is. It's something very, it's like Anderson or something. Well, it's not Anderson, but it's something very kind of waspy and strong. Anyway, God, trending on Twitter this morning was so... Oh, it's Clayton. There you go. That's waspy and strong. John Clayton Mayer. Wow. That's waspy and strong. Trending on Twitter this morning was Helen Keller.
I just saw that.
Because they're questioning whether she was a racist. Are they trying to cancel Helen Keller?
What I saw was that there is now this new level of trolling where you pick a new thing to discount the existence of. So right. I'm see what I saw the most was that she wasn't real.
Oh, you're kidding.
Yeah. So
the other thing trending was Fleetwood Mac. People were debating who's better, Fleetwood Mac or Chicago. First of all, not exactly a hot button topic. I mean, I don't, you know what I mean? Like, I'm not exactly sure what brought that on.
Can we establish a new category of dad Twitter?
Yeah, honestly.
You know, dad Twitter is really on your case right now, John.
Some would argue that's granddad Twitter at this point.
I love dad Twitter.
And by the way, I'm just going to say my vote is Fleetwood Mac. I'm not a big Chicago guy. I was never a big Chicago guy.
I just love that we live in a world with both of them.
Yes, very good. Julie in Arizona has a question for John Clayton Mayer.
John Clayton Mayer.
Good morning, guys. This is literally epic. I mean, Andy, you couldn't have given us a better Monday for the entire year.
Well, let me tell you something. He landed on my doorstep like a little...
I really said, can I come?
Yeah.
He said he was doing the radio Monday morning. I go, can I come?
Yeah, it was good. Amazing. What's your question?
A gift. Okay, so real quick, I saw you a billion years ago on Saturday Night Live. We went, and there you were playing with Frank Ocean. And it was like,
yes,
unbelievable. We did.
No, I was there that night in John's dressing room. And all of his dude buddies were watching. We were watching some huge MMA fight.
No, that was a Travis Scott.
Oh,
that's when I played with Travis Scott. We were watching the Conor McGregor.
Oh, you're right. Okay, sorry. Go ahead.
Anyway, that was a great moment. I was hoping you were going to sing, but either way, just seeing you there was amazing. My question is, okay, so we've all been trapped in quarantine for so long. Like, what would you define as your best day? I know it's kind of a weird because it's not been fun, but like, if you had a day that was just the greatest in quarantine, what did it look like?
It was my birthday. And I learned that the birthday is more necessary than ever before during the pandemic.
Okay.
Because what the birthday
we
is...
We share a birthday.
Do we really?
Oh, that's so great.
October 16th, correct?
Yeah, October 16th. Yeah. So you know what that felt like on October 16th. It's more needed than ever to, you know, when you're sort of unplugged from society, to have your world around you celebrate you. I just thought, not only for me, I went, oh, thank God everyone has a birthday during this, because the love that was piled on was so needed. It was such a burst of encouragement to keep going. And so after the love I felt on my birthday, I kind of become a birthday monster for other people.
Oh, that's
And I never really was. I always thought it was like a technicality.
Right.
And then I realized in times like these, a birthday.
Everybody needs the virtual hug.
Everybody needs 24 hours to be really told how special they are.
That's very sweet.
So they can sort of, like a chipmunk, store it in their cheeks.
Yes.
And live off it for the next several months.
Kara in Wisconsin.
Hey, hi. Hi, Andy.
Hi.
Hi, Kara. I'm a huge fan of both you guys. Andy, I'm really most talkative right now, and I love your holiday hangout with Amy Sedaris. That was a blast. Thanks. But hey, John, I just wanted to tell you, I'm such a big fan, and I saw you at PNC Paint Center in Pittsburgh, and then at Pfizer Forum in Milwaukee. And I just wanted to say, I was the chick with the upside down sign. I don't know if you remember, but my sign was upside down. I was in the third row, and you talked to me. And then you signed my Continuum piano book at the end of the concert in Milwaukee. And it was like the best. It was the best night of my whole life. And I keep everybody says you should frame that piano book with John's autograph. And I think, no, I use it. I use it every day. And
great.
I just love
put it on
having
the piano.
It there.
It was put it on the piano.
Thank you. That's where I have it. I have it on my piano, and I actually play out of it. And people are like, you're going to bend the cover. I don't care. It's just so
meant
cool
to be used.
That you did that.
Yeah, that's great.
I
love it that you put out a Continuum piano book. God, that's so you.
It's so like it. I totally respect using the thing. We all have something we baby. And if that thing you baby has a real utilitarian use, it wants to be used. Use it.
There you go. Thanks, Kara.
Also, when people have signs that are upside down, I think looking back on it now, I didn't think about it till now. I think it's very uncomfortable to have people holding signs up if you feel a little embarrassed.
Right.
And so my tendency is to kind of joke about it.
Right.
If someone has it upside down, it's right. really, it's a way that I can interface with it, because right. without that, I go, that's what you sat at home and made a sign.
Yes.
Like, it makes me, it's so big. It's such an outpouring of love that it makes me uncomfortable that when a sign is upside down, I go like, oh, I can interact with that, because, you know, yeah.
Nikki in California. Hey, Nikki.
Yay. Good morning, guys.
Good morning.
John, I would like to know, since at least 2014 at Howard's birthday party,
yes.
they have been trying to get you on the show, and you still have not gone on, and I want to mm-hmm. know why, and I know the missing comma fiasco didn't help, so in the
I don't know that that would keep me from going on. I mean, yeah. it definitely upset him, and again, I'll say 100% real when I realized, when Andy, there's a lot of previously on,
yes,
you'd have to tell the listener.
You've explained it over and over. Yes.
Well, I don't think that would stop me from going
joking.
On the show.
I'm sorry to interrupt. I was just joking. I don't think it's a missing comma. I want to know.
Okay.
It's not him. It's you. Why do you not want to go on?
Oh.
It's not that I don't want to go on. I think that if you ask most people, based on my reputation, has John Mayer gone on Howard Stern? I sort of have already, in terms of me doing to myself what a Stern appearance would normally do to somebody.
Okay.
So I've self-inflicted a Howard Stern interview over the years. The other reason I haven't done it yet, and I want to do it.
I can't wait.
The other reason that I've waited to do it is because I think, and I'll open up my strategy book a little bit here. I want to do a Howard Stern when there's like six other interviews afterwards, so that if it doesn't go well, I can drown it out with a bunch of other interviews. Imagine doing one interview, it's Howard Stern, it doesn't go well, and I go back into my box.
Listen, you always have an open mic at Radio Andy.
Thank
so
you.
If you ever need to do cleanup duty,
thank you.
You just, Howard is 101 and he's 100 and 101, we're 102. You can move from the Howard
from
hot seat, you move it two notches, and here you are.
I do Howard Stern interviews in my head in
right.
the shower.
Right.
I have been on Stern in my head in these sort of mock practice interviews hundreds of times in the shower.
It's so fun. I will say, wait until everyone's back in person, because you want the feeling
right.
of being in that studio and Fred being there and you're across from
yeah.
Howard.
I'm a giant Howard
yeah,
fan.
I know you
from
yes.
back in the day.
Have you? I know you performed at his birthday thing, but have you ever actually spoken to him face to face?
I've never spoken to him face to face. I'd like to, but until then, it's not the worst thing in the world that there's this incredible sort of aura of other people coming on the show talking about me and him going, so you know John, what's going on?
Right.
I don't hate the mystery that's been built between Howard and myself. I don't hate that part of it, but I am looking forward to demystifying all of it and going on the show.
I am looking forward
to it. Because I could tell you what, there's a 50-50 chance it's the worst decision I ever made in my life, or a three-hour epic conversation that everybody goes, you have to hear it.
Now, let me just call back to you saying you don't jump out of planes and you don't bungee jump. You
yeah.
don't do things that are potentially putting up obstacles in
yeah.
your life. So one could, you're just saying there's a 50-50 chance that it goes well.
In my
that's
mind.
Not the best. Those aren't the best odds. Maybe you should wait until it's better. Coming up in the next hour, we've got the news. We've got some new music out. We have more of your calls, 844-305-2639. It's Andy Cohen Live. It's Monday. It's a good day.
It's good.
We'll be right back. I like this one. Mandy in North Carolina. Where are you in North Carolina, Mandy?
Winston-Salem.
Winston-Salem. Cool. What's your question for John Clayton Mayer?
Well, I want to know, do you think it's odd that people get your song lyrics tattooed on them?
I've been with you several times when people have come up and said, look, I have X or Y lyric on my arm or my back or whatever.
I think it's gorgeous.
You
first of all,
it.
I do think it's gorgeous, but how terrible would people feel if I was like, I'm
yeah, right.
And everybody looks at their arm that says, keep me where the light is, and they go, yeah. oh. No, to be on the other side of a portal that I was once on the other side of, looking at lyrics going, man, I used to write lyrics on my backpack. The things that people say that have been important in my life, I know how that's changed my life. So if someone else has done that with a
what
lyric
what song
of mine,
lyric did you put on your backpack?
All Pearl Jam lyrics.
Really?
Yeah, I was a huge, huge, huge Pearl Jam fan. To this day, I still sort of go soft. Like, I'm all squishy when Pearl Jam comes out. So I know what that feels like to have a piece of language be so important and such a sort of a guide in your life. I think flattering is doesn't even begin to explain. If you've of written course. Something that That's, someone else needs
so personal,
to see, they you know why it's there? For handy reference.
Right. Right.
Right.
I mean, it's a monster. I do have one of your song lyrics on my elbow.
Tell us what it is.
When my daughter was born, it says it's just a wave. I had a stroke on my right side when my daughter was born, and it took me forever to be able to use it again and to be able to do cool things. So I it's on on my elbow. So when I look down and I feel like I can't do any more in the day, it's there.
Oh, it's thank you for saying that.
It's just a wave.
And are you okay now?
Oh, I'm good. I'm good now.
Wow, great.
Great.
Yeah. And by the way, emoji of a wave.
It's just
I
a wave.
That song.
You know, when it comes to that song, it's so sad to remember it's just a wave. You know, I just remember maybe a therapist or someone going like, and when it comes, it's just a wave. And you go, yeah, that's good advice. And then you go, well, it's sad that it's just a wave.
Right.
I want all of these things to empirically check. I want it to bring me back. It's just a wave.
It's Thank
like,
you.
It's like, is all things must pass good news or bad news?
Right.
Right? And whenever someone says all things must pass, I go, that's also bad news for good things.
Right.
Also, bad news for good things is a great album title.
Let's go to Noel in Pennsylvania.
Good morning, John. Good morning, Andy. How are you?
Hey, great. How are you?
Good morning.
Good, good. I have to say, John, I love your cover of EXO by Beyonce. It's one of my favorite covers of all time, and I want to thank you for that cover.
Thank you.
But that's not my question. You're welcome. My question for you is, I love, love, love Current Mood on Instagram, and I miss it so much. What are the plans for the show, and what's on the schedule? I've been missing it.
I think about Current Mood a lot. I love doing it. It's just that it is more of a time suck than anybody knows. So it looks like it's just sort of a lucky shot each time that it works.
Right.
But it really is me.
John puts thought into it. He comes up with bits.
My weekends are gone.
Yeah, literally. He's like, I have a show. I can't talk.
So I give myself till the Wednesday of that week. I'm one guy. I'm the only guy doing
this.
Wednesday, I begin looking at guests and what could be the format of the show. Thursday, I try to secure the guest. By Friday, if I have a guest I get to put up, that's what the show is. Saturday, I'm writing all day. And then from the moment I wake up on Sunday, I'm producing the show. Like, literally using X-Acto knives to cut things.
Right. He makes the sets. He makes the cars.
Video pieces.
Literally.
So... And it's very it's very intense.
People freaked out when Jennifer Aniston commented on one of your current moves. Like, she was watching and she commented, I don't even know what she said, but people were like, people couldn't believe it.
That's star power. When just your emoji or something is enough to make the news, that's a star.
Right, exactly.
You know what I mean?
Exactly. Have you had other people watching that have surprised you?
Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah. I see people and I go, oh, that's neat. You know?
Right.
I really care about the show. And here's what I care about on social media. I call it a line of credit. When you go live, people go, do I want to see that or not? And they actually have a credit score.
Yeah.
And the credit score is every time I click on them, do I get something that I like?
Right.
And if your credit score is low, when it says John Mayer is now going live, you'll go, oh, I'll catch the next one.
Right.
So for me, I think the reason so many people watch Current Mood is because there's this little trust that what they're going to watch has some kind of production or form to it.
Absolutely.
And to do that correctly, it takes up the energy that I want to use these days for making music.
And you also, oh, okay.
So the next time I'm in a break, I would have all that extra energy to do a show. And one of these days I'll do another 10.
You were talking about Pearl Jam. Were you a Kurt Cobain Nirvana fan?
What a great question. I was.
It was
not.
Lisa, my producer's question.
I was not. And as I get older, I can appreciate it. Because I was a melody guy growing up. Everything had to be like so overtly melodic that it took me until I had to be older to understand Nirvana and appreciate Nirvana. And I think they're incredible now. Or I should say, now I think they're incredible. And so I just had to grow up a little bit and understand what that was. But as a late in life pickup of getting it, I love Nirvana.
Wow.
Yeah.
By the way, we played this last time you were on the radio. And I just want to throw out a few more because I love talking. I love doing this with everybody who has a colorful big life, which is, have you met them?
Let's go.
Have you met Cher?
I've never met Cher.
Okay.
I would love to meet Cher. And that is someone I think, now I like everyone. My fear is never if I would like someone.
Yeah, yeah.
My fear is would they like me?
Okay.
I think Cher would like me very. I think Cher and I would be fast friends.
She got great taste. Have you met, did you ever meet Aretha Franklin, the Queen of Soul?
I never met Aretha Franklin, never the Queen of Soul.
I have to assume you were in the same orbits many times at Grammy events or whatever. Now, which presidents have you met?
I've
met Clinton.
I've seen Bill Clinton in a room. I believe I might have shaken his hand very quickly. I might be in a picture with him. I don't remember. Hope that's not mean that I don't remember. But I did meet President Obama and First Lady Michelle Obama when I went to the White House. But I was dating Miss Katy Perry at the time. And so the reason I say this...
Were you guest of Katy Perry at that White House
visit? I was a plus one for Katy Perry.
And so when you're going to the White House, and it kind of... You're going as a plus one.
It's kind of going as the first gentleman of...
Katy Perry.
Katy Perry.
Is there any ego about that for you?
No,
where
I
you
love...
feel like... You loved that.
I know I'm good at what I do.
Okay.
I got no problem entering into someone else's world.
This is Katie's invite to the White House.
Oh, it's her night.
But how did you know it was her night? Like, was she performing
there? Well, yeah, she was instrumental in some of those states, I think, going to Obama.
Oh, right. Yes, she was really,
she would go perform in these states that were on the
And so when you went to the White House with her, was it for, like, a state dinner or something?
It was... The night of the inauguration.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, no, there was a party at the White House. We were dancing in the White House, and I knew...
I never know this? And what was that like? I mean, everyone had... I'm assuming Beyonce was there?
Yeah, everyone was in this room. But I also was very deferential that, like, this is not my night. I'm not the pop star here. But I enjoy that. Like, that was actually kind of cool because I do a different thing. We were two different sides of the same...
Yes,
puzzle, which
yes,
was really
two big
good.
Pop star.
Nobody
so when she performed at the Super Bowl, and you were her date,
I was there.
I remember you loved that.
I'm so proud
of her. Loved it.
That's why a relationship like that can work, because I know where my bread is buttered, and it's not. I know that it's not like I was sitting there going like, I sure hope they pick me for the Super Bowl.
Yeah, right.
Never getting picked for the Super Bowl. Right. I have no problem. I do a different thing. So I always was. I actually very much enjoyed. The pop in, kiss during makeup. Okay, we're going upstairs. Be great. I'm good at being that.
That's so interesting.
Many
people would think that wouldn't be the case and that two pop stars shouldn't be together.
I think as I got older and my confidence was more deeply set into me and less arrogant.
Yeah.
I have no problem turning it off.
Right.
I know that I'm going to be fine if I pick up a guitar. So I can afford emotionally to go support someone else.
That's great.
Yeah.
Now, what would you say, we're talking about Katy at the Super Bowl, what would you say was the single highest profile gig or song or moment that you have ever played
for yourself? Michael Jackson's funeral.
Whose funeral?
Michael Jackson's funeral.
Really?
Yeah.
And what did you play at Michael Jackson's funeral?
I played Human Nature.
Wow.
And I didn't sing. Because I didn't want to, and I couldn't.
Okay.
I just don't have the range for it. There's nothing.
Did you play an acoustic version?
I just played it on the electric guitar, and I think the absence of a vocal had this real beautiful kind of tribute to sort of highlighting his absence as a way of tributing his talent. Instead of me trying to retrace those lines, I was never going to be able to do that. So. I remember being in a trance when I did that and being sure it was terrible.
Really?
I'd actually forgotten my in-ears. So in-ears are these things you wear, you can hear yourself. And I, in all of the hubbub, I remember walking to the stage from my seat at the Staples Center, and I went, oh my God, I don't have my in-ears. So I couldn't really hear anything when I played. And I was sure for hours that it was no good.
And
then in a very rare moment of finding out it was better than you thought, not worse than you thought, it started to sort of blossom into this thing that I realized, oh, this was special.
Did you watch it ever?
Yeah, I watched it back.
You did?
And I thought it was so from the heart that it wasn't even about technique or anything. It was just purely from the heart. And that was one of those moments. And I think the world's a little different now because we're a little less synchronized with seeing the same things.
Yeah.
But I remember everywhere I walked, people went, saw you. Wow. I mean, everyone watched that. Huh. I think moving forward now, media and entertainment is so segmented that you don't get that critical mass that was.
Did you know Michael Jackson?
I never knew Michael Jackson.
Never met him.
Never met him. I mean, he was a recluse.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I dig that about LA. You could be a megastar and still not be seen. You throw up a gate and live the rest of your life without being seen. So he wasn't really like at places.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I'd hear of him like shutting down places in Vegas.
Did you ever meet Johnny Cash?
Never met Johnny Cash. That would have been cool.
Have you met Reba?
Never met Reba. And I hope I have. I mean, I would remember if I met her.
Have you met Dolly? She called into my show when you hosted the birthday show.
Dolly.
But
you know how I feel about Dolly. You know, I've said to you, I want to write a Dolly. I want to write a song. Not that she needs any help.
Yes.
But I want to
You want to collaborate with her.
I want to write that one.
You want to write the one with her. Well, I want you to watch the Dolly doc.
I'd love, you know, you don't know this. Andy is constantly trying to get me to watch things. Now, this is the bane of the existence of those around me. I don't watch most things.
He doesn't watch TV, you guys. And so he won't binge.
I won't binge.
Right.
So he'll say to me, I need you to watch 3 documentaries.
Yes.
And he'll prioritize them. John, number one, I need you to watch the Bee Gees.
Right.
Number
and
two,
I did
Ronald
get
Reagan.
You to watch the
I
Bee
watched
Gees.
The Bee Gees documentary.
Thank God. So the Reagans and the Dolly doc are
and
still on the list.
They're still on the list.
Yes, they're
but
still on the list.
But then I'll pull like an Audible and all of a sudden it'll be Barb and Star Go to Vista Del Mar.
Right. Did you see that?
Yes.
You're kidding me.
Yes.
I'm stunned.
You have to watch it.
I saw it. I interviewed the cast.
What did
on
you
the
think
radio.
About Barb and Star Go to Vista Del Mar?
You know what? It's so funny. I have a thing where if I watch movies at home, there's always a moment where I'm like, am I going to turn this movie on?
Yes.
And I was so glad that I kept it. First of all, anything Kristen Wiig does, I absolutely love. I just thought it was a perfectly, I think that's a movie that will be better and better. Every time it's on and you're flipping by, you're like, oh, I want to watch this. I thought it was fun.
I think it's
crazy.
Bonkers.
Yeah, it's
and,
so bonkers.
And I walk around
it
going,
bonkers.
I can't tell you if it's good.
It right.
might not be good.
Right.
I can only tell you that I laughed way beyond the threshold
I totally
of
agree.
A number of times that would constitute a funny movie.
It was something that you, first of all, I'm stunned that you watched Barb and Star. I didn't know you watched.
Everyone listening has to watch Barb and Star.
Yes.
If you're a fan of the kind of comedy that kind of rubs your sternum and kind of aggravates you just a little bit until you laugh.
Yeah.
I'm a fan of Cabin Boy with Chris Elliott.
We need a Seagulls in the Sand cover from you, maybe.
Done.
That's the Jamie Dornan song. Do you... one thing that I was also very surprised, kind of, that you watched was the Britney doc.
I watched the Britney doc.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Any random thoughts on that? Or
yes. I'm going to give you a thought on the Britney doc. Obviously, there's a lot to parse on a sociological level. I almost cried 5 times during that.
Really?
Yeah. Now, there's a debate as to whether the times in and of themselves kind of encased this behavior.
Yep.
Right. Like it's hard to go back into SAP and cut into it. And because it is sort of suspended in amber, some of this stuff.
Yeah.
But to see the sadness in this human being, I was on the edge of tears 5 times, because if you understand what this business / industry / lifestyle does to a person, and you to go through this and come out the other side okay, is to have infinite grace for those who struggle with it. I came out okay. I have a feeling that part of that is because I'm a man. I have a very strong feeling that part of that is because I'm a man.
Wow.
And I have a very strong feeling that a lot of these things that happen to female performers is endemic to being female. Mm-hmm. Why do so many men emerge going, learn my lesson. Yes, I got dinked in the head.
Right.
But I'm back, baby.
Right.
So I watched it with such grace for someone who got much more maligned by the inhuman experiment of fame than I did.
Yep.
And I go, why did I get through that? Yep. Why did I find my way through that obstacle course? Yep. What was afforded to me stylistically, mm-hmm. right? The stylistic difference
yep.
of being an outlaw. If you're a man, you're an outlaw. Mm-hmm. If you're a woman, you're kind of crazy.
Yep.
And when I watched that through that lens, my heart just ached the whole time.
You, I asked you, at, well put, by the way, wow, there's a major weather it's system snowing. Moving
Merry
in.
Christmas.
I just see it has begun. I'm looking out the window and it is waves of, is that snow?
Any Christmas plans, Andy?
Yeah, honestly. I asked you, as we're getting back to, have you met them? I asked you what your intersections with Brittany were. I
never met Brittany.
Never met her.
Yeah, never met her.
But that's so interesting also, because you were in that Jessica Simpson
but I
vortex.
Think,
and I would have thought that she would have been.
It's easier than you think in Los Angeles to run your own ecosystem.
Now, when you were coming up, was TRL a big thing?
TRL was a big thing. I was on it like so perfunctorily.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, I was never a pop star.
Right.
And my worst years were when I thought I was.
Right. Did you ever have a thing? Did you and Timberlake ever like, were you guys ever buddies like in a social way?
I really like that guy. I always say about Timberlake, I go, that's as normal as a guy's going to be considering, again, what he went through in the inhuman experiment of child fame.
Right.
That I mean, you know, he's.
Have you met J.C. Chazet?
I must have met all the NSYNC boys. But Justin and I got together years ago in a hotel room and we're.
Ooh, I like
worked
this.
On some music together it's a very interesting thing. You don't have to be besties with everyone to respect the music and. You know.
Have you met Janet?
I have met Janet. I adore Janet.
Really?
And I adore, and I haven't seen her in years and years and years. Oh my goodness.
Where did you?
A couple of parties. I might have seen her at like one of those.
Uh-huh.
It's when you're young and you're coming up, you're not sure whose house you're at or
what
street you're on. So I couldn't tell you where I was because I had no like map quest in my brain as to where I was. But that's a powerhouse of a soul. I can tell you that. That's a powerhouse of the
There's soul. So many fun things about being friends with John, but I will say one of the fun things is when he takes me to some super insider party. I remember going to some Oscar party with you, and it's just always an adventure because you don't know who you're going to run into. That thing of where are we?
Did we go to the Oscar right before the pandemic? Were you with me?
You came to Brian's party.
Yeah,
right before the pandemic.
We
hung out, and I introduced you to Allison Janney.
We had
you
so
two
much
had
fun.
A little love
so
moment.
Much fun. Like I'm only now at the point where I can go to a party and not feel terrible. Like it took me 20 years
really
to go to a party and not feel like psychically beat down by everyone else.
Really?
Yeah, I'm a very sensitive guy. I'm so sensitive. I'm wondering about the Justin Timberlake thing now.
Right.
That's not a mean thing I said. I mean,
you put it into context beautifully.
Okay,
are you kidding me? Absolutely not.
I'm trying to be Switzerland about
absolutely not. I think maybe what we'll do is take a wee break, and then we'll come back and we'll get into a little news, and we'll recalibrate.
Yeah.
We're still here. It is really snowing now in New York City. What can I tell you? 844-305-2639. That spells Andy. We'll be right back.
It's just a way that I know that when it comes, I just hold on. I just hold on.
It's just a wave, dude.
It's just a wave. Oh, honey.
I've been talking to myself just to hear you. You're saying everything I wish you would. And it's so good. It's raining on the mission bell. They're draining out the mission bell. It breaks my heart.
No computers here on this one.
Honestly.
It breaks my heart. I'm not singing this side as well.
Oh, honey.
You take it.
Oh, honey. It's just a wave. It's just a wave. And I know that when it comes.
That's me in the morning.
That style,
that part of my voice is a tricky one.
Ah, what a special morning. The snow is falling outside. And I feel like you deposited something good inside us today.
Thank you.
Is it really already over? No, it's not. We have a half hour left. Sorry. I don't know if you're trying to get out of here. I know you're going to see your dad again this morning.
You know, when I'm not on... Yeah, I am. I'm going to go see my dad. Oh. When I'm not talking to someone in public for a while, I get very sensitive and vulnerable. And if you ask me what would a good life be, it'd be one where I never say anything in public. And
right.
It toughens me up again.
Okay,
I have thoughts.
Yes,
I have
you
feelings.
Have so many.
And at some point, I've got to toughen up myself. We talk about stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
This is what these headphones are for.
That's right. This is what we do. That was John Mayer singing live to Emoji of a Wave. If you ever had any questions about whether his voice was as good as it is on the recording at 11:30 in the morning, you just got your answer. Let's get into the news on this Monday morning. Kim Kardashian and Kanye West's marriage hit its turning point in 2018. Us Weekly says the turning point was, any idea
me?
What you think the turning point in their marriage was?
This sounds like so you're telling me a news story that references 2018.
Yes. Us Weekly says that the turning point was when Kanye West said that slavery was a choice. Apparently, Kim was completely mortified by Kanye's ridiculous and outrageous comments. Took a lot for them to move past it, but they were eventually. Kim filed for divorce on Friday after nearly 7 years of marriage. A source called People Magazine, Kanye West thinks there was a reason that the marriage, he thinks one thing cost him his marriage. Any idea what you think that might be?
Andy, I'm drawing a blank.
He thinks it was his failed presidential run.
Well, it's a story as old as time.
Yes.
Remember the Norman Rockwell painting of the man having the failed presidential run?
Yes.
And his wife and kid?
Yes.
It's just Americana.
The source went on to say he thinks the presidential run was the straw that broke the camel's back. Before that, there was hope. After that, none. Cost his marriage. I'm skipping this Allen versus Pharaoh.
I guess looking back on it, the moment I realized my relationship with my wife was over was when I built that giant space laser and destroyed Mars. I see a lot of America can look at itself in the mirror of this family.
Oh, my God. Sending love to Brooke Shields this morning.
Why?
She said she broke her femur. She's beginning to recover.
Do you know where the femur is, Andy?
I don't. What is it,
John? Femur is in the leg. It's your femur is actually up here. It's in your thigh.
Ah. Yeah. Well, she shared a video of herself yesterday from a hospital practicing to walk with crutches. She captioned the clip, "Broke my femur. Beginning to mend."
Did she say what she did to break the femur?
No, she said, no matter what your challenge is, make a positive choice for yourself to move forward. # beginning is now.
You got to do something pretty heavy to fracture a femur.
Yeah, you do.
Skiing accident?
Right.
I'd love to know more about this this injury.
Huh. I do too. Khloe Kardashian shares new diamond ring photo, sparking more engagement speculation. She posted a photo of herself with a massive diamond ring, renewing speculation of a possible engagement with longtime boyfriend Tristan Thompson. Huh, there you go. Who knows? Did you ever date Kim Kardashian?
No, never. I think she's lovely.
Yeah, she is.
A lovely human being,
yeah,
right?
She is. Yeah, she really is.
I mean,
and very smart, by the way.
Yeah,
Neo is overjoyed to announce baby number 5 is on the way.
And also broke his femur. What is Hollywood doing
with their femurs? Patrick Mahomes and Brittany Matthews welcome their first child.
Now, those are two sexy names.
You think Mahomes is a sexy name?
Patrick Mahomes and Brittany Matthews just sound like two hot people.
Yeah, well, they are. Do you know who Patrick Mahomes is?
I believe he is a professional football player. Yes. I believe he is a quarterback.
Yes.
Yes.
Can you name the team?
Is he on the Kansas City Chiefs?
Ding, 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 ding. John Mayer for the win.
Thank you.
Well done.
I would have liked to have been wrong.
I was a little worried.
I still may be, and you're being nice to me. I don't know.
Two women dressed up as grannies to try to get vaccinated in Florida. The women were 34 and 44, not over 65. They were dressed up with various accessories, including spectacles, to try to receive the vaccine in Orlando, Florida. While they didn't succeed this time, they presented valid CDC prevention cards indicating they had already received their first dose.
So let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
Do you think, as wrong as it is to have done what they did, it's equally wrong not to give them the second dose, ethically speaking?
No, I don't think they got the first dose. They were turned away.
No, they got the first dose. That's how they got the card, I would think.
Oh, right. Yeah, you're right. They indicated they had already received, unless their valid CDC prevention cards were, like, forged or something.
I don't know how they don't go, ladies, this is really reprehensible, but we have to give you the second dose because we're not going to be walking around with one dose. So I question whether they secretly got the second dose and then were reprimanded. But also, if you already have the card that says you have the first dose, I would think that's all the documentation you'd need. It seems like a lot of going through trouble. Also, they didn't look, I couldn't quite see where they were pulling off the old thing.
Yeah, I don't either. I love the idea of dressing up as the elderly. I mean, it's so crazy.
You know, we're on a cruise ship and it's sinking and there are lifeboats.
Right.
Whenever someone stands next to the lifeboat and goes, I know that I'm a fully grown man.
Right.
And the women and children are not off the boat yet.
Right.
But there is a lifeboat and it's being lowered right down into the water right now. And there's an open seat. I say no more, but what are you doing?
John, it is. I just have to point out that it's magical outside.
It's the snow is blowing sideways.
The snow is blowing sideways.
We are in a snow globe.
We're in a snow globe.
Normally, you show me these things on Marco Polo or FaceTime.
Right, or Instagram. Right. Yes. By the way, our producer Lisa is reminding me that last time you were on, you said the Kardashian you'd be most interested in dating was Kris.
I still think she's so endearing.
Yes.
Yeah, every time I see her, I go, and that, by the way, that would be very me, right? The John Mayer thing to do would be to go to the queen bee with the most influence, and then you could say you were sort of plugged into the mother brain.
Right.
Yeah, that would be.
Have you heard about the big scandal with Emily in Paris, the Netflix show?
That it was feted with a bunch of Golden Globe nominations?
Yeah, and The Los Angeles Times has published a report on alleged ethical conflicts and a culture of corruption within the Hollywood Foreign Press Association, which is, of course, the oldest con job around. Basically, in one example,
I can't say that I have a short film coming out soon. So I
You ever been nominated for a Golden Globe?
No, but I did do a song for the movie The Bucket List, as someone.
Oh, really? Did you?
And I remember meeting those
the Hollywood Foreign Press men and women in hopes maybe of getting a nomination.
Oh yeah, it was.
Yes, it was a schmooze event.
It was a schmooze event. Yeah.
Interesting. Yet you didn't get the nomination.
You didn't get the nomination.
Wow.
Yeah, that was the song "Say."
Oh, really?
From the bucket list. Yeah.
Lisa, find out what did get nominated that year, if you can, and let's. I would like John and I to go over those songs.
They're all going to be. Let me save you time.
Five songs.
They're all well deserving. All five are deserving.
I want to see.
I'm not putting these headphones down and walking away going, oh, I ripped on three songs.
I just want to go through them and see what were nominated the year that the movie Bucket
List. But if you do that, you're going to have to call into question the song Say, which is highly repetitive.
Is Say What You Mean.
Say what you need to say. Say what
that
you
was
need
a big
say.
Hit for you, wasn't it?
It was big enough.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's like kind of a quintessential.
It's in the mix of that era of me hitting those marks. Yeah.
Yeah. Disney Plus added a disclaimer
for Muppet Show.
Muppet Show. The disclaimer reads, these stereotypes were wrong. And wrong then and wrong now, rather than remove the content, we want to acknowledge its harmful impact, learn from it, and spark conversation to create a more inclusive future together. Now, there's a part of me that would think it's a little snowflakey to add a disclaimer to the Muppet Show. But let me say that I would rather the negative depiction disclaimer then erase the Muppet Show at all from Disney Plus.
Yes.
So I might have gone into this story thinking that this was a little overdoing it, but I like this actually.
I, when I read this, just wanted to know some examples, not so I could debate them,
right?
Because I was fascinated as to what exactly that was. And I think it would speak to part of the problem that you and I have no memory of the Muppet Show being anything other than just absolutely soft and endearing.
Of course not, but it is incredible.
Do you have any memory? Do you have a memory of something happening on the Muppet Show?
No, but you know what? They could have had a Muppet come in and be some queenie
right.
stereotype of a gay guy.
Right.
It could be, you know, who knows? I mean, it really could be anything because everything was permitted. I was watching a rerun or a clip of the Donnie and Marie show the other day, and I can't remember what was on, but I was like, wow,
yeah.
That wouldn't go today.
I think it's a byproduct of having so much access to things from all different times now. I mean, we live in a library where you can just pull up the microfiche and look at it. And I think it's very confusing to your brain to look at something that, especially things that are filmed in, you know, when you look at something from 1970, right, the coloring and the softness of the film and the grain, it lets you know this was a different era.
Uh-huh.
I think when we got into a point where 20 years ago still looks like today with uh-huh. video, your brain, if you're 24 years old, your brain can't accurately understand that that's 20 Christmases ago, that's 24th of July's ago. Your brain looks at it and goes, well, I'm seeing it now. This is the first I've heard
right,
of it.
Right, right.
So this is a new experience.
Right.
And so that's very, very tricky. And it's also the reason that I still have people discovering my music when I haven't put a record out in 3 years, right? Like, there's this new feeling that everything online is instantly accessible and sort of is all happening right now as you're experiencing it, which is good for me in that sense. But you'll also watch something and go, oh no, oh no. And you go, well, this was 20 years ago, and your brain can't quite parse that correctly. You know?
Okay, I just want to tell you the song that won the Golden Globe the year you weren't nominated.
Okay.
It was Peter Gabriel and Romis Newman won for Down to Earth from WALL-E.
Did I get it? Pixar movie.
I mean, I don't remember that song. Anyway.
Well, thank you. That's very sweet of you. Yes. You're being my cheerleader.
Right.
Thank you.
We are. I am always your
cheerleader. You really are. Thank you.
We are going to take a break. When we come back, I just thought of a new game to play with you that I just thought of.
Love it.
That I'm very excited about.
Oh, I thought you were playing this. Okay.
You say I'm crazy. I got you crazy. You're nothing but a womanizer.
Hard to turn that song off. I love a Britney jam.
They've aged really well.
They have. We're back. John Mayer is my guest co-host today, surprise guest co-host. So I was just looking through all your credits and all your stuff you've done, and I was thinking, okay, here could be a funny game. I'm just going to throw out something that you did in your past. You tell me the first thing you remember from doing that thing.
Great.
You were on an episode of CSI in 2006?
Yes.
What did you do?
This was at the time that there was great integration between music and television.
Okay.
So it was all about breaking songs on television.
Okay.
If you had a song on Grey's Anatomy, boom, you know. If you had a song on Alias.
What song did you break? Do you remember?
I think I played Waiting on the World to Change. This was right when Continuum started.
Okay.
And I remember I had a terrible headache from the TV lights. Like, TV lights just give me instant migraine.
Really?
Yeah, really bad headache. But that actually moved the needle to be on CSI.
Well, something else that must have moved the needle, and you and I have never discussed this. You were on Oprah in 2006, probably performing, but have you been on Oprah a bunch? Were you on that show a bunch of times?
No, but she and I have written each other over the years. And again, that's another, I could tell you who will and won't like me. Maybe it's just my own pathology, but I'm usually pretty right. That's
you feel like Oprah
feel
would
a
like you.
Yeah, I think
do you remember being on the Oprah
very
show?
Very much. It was a live show. That was the thrust of the show, is that they were live shows. And
you performed live.
I think I performed live, and then we
Chicago.
Talked just a little bit. Yeah,
right.
I was in her studio. Yeah.
Wow. Do you remember in 2007 performing at Live Earth, the concerts for a climate crisis?
Let me tell you about this story.
Okay.
So the Police were, I think, sort of like the main act, because they had just gotten back together.
Okay.
And they called, the Police called a meeting in the dressing room with the three members of the Police, Sting, Andy Summers, Stuart Copeland, Kanye West, and me. And we're going over like what we were going to do, because Kanye came out for one of the Police songs. I think it was Message in a Bottle. He came out.
Okay.
And Andy Summers, the guitar player, takes out his acoustic guitar and kneels on the ground. And I take out my acoustic guitar. And he shows me the hidden guitar harmony in
Message
in a Bottle. And it was one of the greatest moments of my life. He taught me this other guitar line from the dude who wrote that part.
Wow.
The only guy who knows how it goes. He's the guy who went, oh, I'm going to harmonize this on the record. And sure as day, it's on the record. And I played that harmony that night. He taught me how to play. And so I backed him up with that harmony.
Wow.
And then Kanye came out and did a thing. But I have pictures of us hanging out in that dressing room. And that was a very special night.
Wow.
Yeah, that was cool.
Do you have like a text relationship with Kanye?
I don't. But When we see each other, it's special.
It's collegial.
Well, it's more than that. I mean, we came up together.
Yeah, you did.
I mean, I walked into Sony recording studios in 2004 to do something for my second record, and they said, Kanye West is down the hall. He's doing a listening party, and I didn't know who he was.
Wow.
And then when I heard the music, I went, oh my God.
Right.
And then, you know, you move on in life. But you have these relationships with people where you know you'll always be vulnerable to each other.
Yeah.
So when I see him, a lot of the whatever he's invented, which I'm a fan. I mean, we're all sort of inventions as artists.
Yeah.
I like that for certain people, because you came up together, the invention turns off and you get the person.
Right.
So there's a short list of people that I won't ever be my invention around, and vice versa. And I think that era of time, whenever I see Kanye, he gives me Kanye.
You performed live at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 2001.
A couple of times, yeah.
At induction ceremonies?
Yeah, I've inducted a few people.
Who
and
have
performed.
You inducted?
I inducted Stevie Ray Vaughan, which was a milestone of my life. I inducted Albert King.
Okay.
And when Elton John inducted Leon Russell, I had the honor of playing the guitar, just me and Leon, doing one of the greatest songs ever written, Song for You.
Wow.
You know A Song for You?
Yes. You know who covered A Song for
Donny
You?
Donny Hathaway made it. Donny Hathaway made it his
Whitney
big,
Houston also.
Whitney Houston.
Yeah.
Everyone, all roads at some point lead through that song.
Yes, absolutely.
He says, listen to the melody, because my love is in there hiding. He's writing the song about what that song is and how it should be remembered forever as a message of love.
Wow.
Forget it.
You performed on SNL in 2003. Do you remember who the host was? Of course.
The host was Jack Black.
Yes.
And I it wasn't my best record.
Okay.
And so I didn't quite have the songs to make a great performance out of, but I had a really good time. And then since then, I've been on SNL more times as a guest, to the point where, and I'll give you a little bit of gossip, there have been several artists who have said, will you come on SNL and be a guest on the song? And I go, absolutely. And they call me back and they go, you've been on too many times, they won't let me have you on.
Really?
Because I've been standing behind people. So there have been other artists like, I can't, they won't let me, which I think is a wonderful little stat.
I think having you in the background is the coolest thing. I don't understand. But also it begs the question, it does make me wonder why you haven't been the solo performer more. That seems odd.
I'll tell you why. And now I love this about my career. I was never quite attached to a culture. I was never quite claimed as being someone's guy, right? So,
but you always had hit songs.
I mean, no, I didn't always. See, this is the misnomer. I always had good songs,
right?
But those good songs may or may not have worked in the universe of music in any given year. Got I'm it. Really happy to have the songs I have now. So the things that were uncool then or didn't really find a slot in culture then are all my babies now, and they all sound good and they're all worth playing. But I understand that I was kind of a man without a country musically, that nobody quite wanted to go like, yeah, we align with Mayer. Because remember, I had Your Body as a Wonderland and these songs that at the very beginning kind of painted me as this kind of bubblegummy pop guy.
Uh-huh.
And I really like over the years that I have sort of warmed myself up to people and vice versa. And now I feel like I have a really good lot in life. I watched the Frank Ocean SNL thing that we did 1 week ago, actually, because someone had brought it up on Instagram or something. Uh-huh. It's the greatest thing I've ever done.
Wow.
It's
wow.
the best thing I've ever done.
Wow, that's saying something.
I watched it and I had shivers that so hard it hurt. I had a chill up my spine watching how good it was. And it was him, you know.
Some might argue that your co-hosting appearance today
would be one of the
one
greatest,
of the greatest things.
Well, you know, I have like a 48-hour watch period after I open my mouth to make sure that I don't get in trouble. I just have, you know.
You beat yourself up.
I go into mental quarantine after one of these
things. Yes, you do. Are you going to be worried today as you...
I'll text you a few times.
Will you?
Yeah, this is my problem. I have so many thoughts. Most of them are good.
Right.
But none of my thoughts, I need to share enough to make it worth someone calling me and going, so I wish you would have told me you went on Andy's. We could have prepped. I wish you would have told me.
Right.
And it's not when people go, look, it's not the end of the world, but it's just...
Oh, I hate that.
I don't have
but
the constitution
for it. You're not going to get that call. It's a beautiful snowy day in New York. You made my day, John, hanging out with me. Maybe you'll walk with me 10 steps from my house and pick Ben up.
I would
right
love
now.
To.
That would be great. Going to pick Ben up from school. On Wednesday's show, activist Sean King will be here. That should be interesting. And a whole lot more. We're going to have a major Kiki. John.
So much fun.
Can't thank you enough.
Thank you.
Really. We're going out on some John Mayer.
Listen to that song.
The way we came in. Wow.
You tell me.
Is that your imitation of yourself there?
It's very early on in the singing.
Everybody have a great day from John and I.
Have a great day. Thanks for listening to me talk, prattle on for 2 hours.
And me too. Really great. Jeff Lewis Live is coming up. Hey, if you're on the East Coast, enjoy the snow, everybody. It's magic here.
Great.
Merry Christmas,
Merry Christmas,
John.
One and all.
Merry Christmas, one and all. Thanks, guys. Wave to the team. Thanks. Have a great day.